It was in late 1949 when Mahatma Gandhi had been assassinated and India's constitution was about to be adopted. That 1947 to 1950 period constitution making, and on 26 January we adopted the constitution of a new India, independent India. Jawaharlal Nehru, the then chosen Prime Minister or designated Prime Minister, was in search of a president, because in the India's constitution, as you are perhaps well aware, that used to be similar to Sri Lankan constitution till 1918, I think, when you sort of transformed it to a presidential form, more than. So, parliamentary form, the leader of the largest party is the prime minister, and then you have a president. And Mahatma Gandhi had told Jawaharlal Nehru, clever as he was, that he should approach Purushottam Das Tandon of Allahabad to be the first president of India. And Rajarshi, as Purushottam Das Tandon used to be known, Gandhi thought of him because Gandhi knew that Jawaharlal Nehru was a cosmopolitan, Western educated, more liberal, but perhaps without roots in the rural soil of the country. And Purushottam Das would provide a counterweight, a counterpoint. So Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru also grew up, as you know, in Allahabad. There were Kashmiri Pandits who had migrated to Allahabad in UP. Allahabad is not very far from Varanasi. So when he reached Allahabad back and went to Purushottam Das's house and said, "This is what Bapu had asked me to request you," Purushottam Das Tandon thought for a while and he said, "No, Jawahar, since you are anyway the Prime Minister designate, and if I become the President, we will spend next 5 years disagreeing. So you leave me out of the government, because that's not good for the country. If the Prime Minister and President in the first 5 years of independent India continue to disagree, then the country won't. But since you are the chosen one, I can suggest to you, if you agree, to go to Rajendra Prasad ji in Patna. He will be okay with you." And he picked up the phone and talked to Rajendra Prasad, and that's how Rajendra Prasad became the first president of independent India. And the two, Jawahar and Rajendra Prasad, went along well. Why I am narrating you this story at the beginning of this conversation is to suggest that there are two different spaces for acting in the interest of society. There is a space within political parties and political process, the formal political process, in a largely democratic setup. And then there is a space outside. And Purushottam Das Tandon chose the space outside. He continued to be an ardent critique of Jawaharlal Nehru's policies, but he never joined the government, neither during independence struggle nor afterwards. Let me cut back to April 2002. In April 2002, the then Prime Minister, Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and the Vice Chair of the then Planning Commission, Sri K.C. Pant, some of you know these names, convened a dialogue in the illustrious Vigyan Bhavan where all the official meetings take place in Delhi, with Indian voluntary sector. And the theme was, how can we work together in national development? This conversation took place 2-3 months after the, 2 months after the terrible incidents in Gujarat, in Godhra. And it so transpired, because members of the Planning Commission seemed to know me, that I was invited to be representing the voice of civil society, which is a dangerous proposition in itself. You can only represent your voice. Try represent voice of civil society anywhere and you will be shot down, because you can't represent. You can only speak for yourself. So, Atal Bihari Vajpayee had a ready-made speech in front of him in English. And we sort of stood on the dais, lit the lamp, and released a book together, some sort of guidelines for working together between Planning Commission and Indian voluntary sector. And then my turn came to speak. Knowing Atal Bihari and knowing most people in the crowd, I spoke in extempore Hindi. To only make this point that his vocation in life for 50 years was to transform India, bring about improvements in the lives of every Indian through formal political process and parliamentary democracy. And that people like me had similar mission to transform India, to improve the lives of every citizen of India, but from another space, from another standpoint. Not necessarily away from or isolated from what the parties and the government did, but certainly independent of, occasionally shaking hands together, periodically disagreeing publicly, and even questioning. I must say that Atal Bihari, sharp dude as he was, an excellent parliamentarian, an excellent prime minister, stood up and said, since Dr. Rajesh Tandon has spoken in Hindi and his speech was assumed to be read, I am saying that you kindly assume my written speech read in English. And then he also spoke extempore in Hindi. That conversation, for no more than 45 minutes in these, later on became the basis for when the new government in India came in 2004 to formulate a national policy on the role and contributions of voluntary sector in India, which was approved by the cabinet of Dr. Manmohan Singh in 2007, July 2007, but could not be tabled in parliament because of the resistance from among the allies. And most prominent ally at that time, if you remember, in UPA-1 was the left party led by CPM. In the theory of CPM, there was no space for anybody, Communist Party Marxist, there was no space for any other actor to pursue social well-being of society unless they were part of the party. So party was supreme, everything else followed. If you were not part of the party or a front organization of the party, student organization, women's organization, union organization, if you're not part of the party umbrella, you had no locus standi to speak on behalf of the people, to work towards improving their lives in ways which sometimes will support government policies and programs, and many a times question, critique, and even oppose. It was during this era of 2002 to 2007 that a number of organizations began to focus their attention far more on questions of accountability of government. And the Right to Information Act, which was enacted in 2005, provided a further impetus to make seeking of information and demanding accountability, transparency and accountability, doable within a possible legal framework. The most, in my view, the first most telling event happened in Mumbai a day after the attack in November 2008. You may remember Taj Hotel and several hotels were almost spontaneously, largely through the use of SMS, thousands of young people gathered in Mumbai's famous Marine Drive to demand substantive security and political action from first the mayor of Mumbai and then the chief minister of Maharashtra and then the prime minister of India. That demonstration, some estimates suggest more than 60,000 people, mostly young people, was the first illustration in public domain that those of us who occupied the self-occupied, the civil society space, were actually disconnected in some respect with those 50,000 young people who had reached Mumbai's Marine Drive to protest. And its further evidence, therefore, triggered after 2009, when anti-corruption, India Against Corruption movement gained momentum, led by Anna Hazare and several other social activists from around the country. And there were two episodes in that movement which are very, very illustrative of the new wave of citizen action that India was witnessing in the 21st century, to which many of us who had believed in that space, independent of political space and political party space, were feeling a bit disconnected from, somewhat unsure what it was. The first was the amazingly spontaneous congregation of people, not just in Delhi, when the movement of India Against Corruption in 2010, but in practically every district around the country. And what was distinguishing feature of this was that there were people cutting across age profile, class profile. What had made a difference was not just the mainstream media, but also the social media, the other forms of communication, particularly the use of SMS. Because as you know, we have nearly 900 million mobile connections in India. Of course, we have around 400 million toilets, but that's the model of development India is going through. So more people have mobile than toilets. Life's priorities these days. I hope they all don't have constipation, but anyway. So the spontaneity of response of people in support of the movement led by Anna Hazare was not just what was happening on Ramlila ground in Delhi and the tent and all these people gathering there and singing and protesting, but in each, almost every district. Which was saying something about what people were feeling, what they were looking for as an organizing principle to articulate those feelings. The second episode in that, if you remember, Anna's demand was a Ombudsman Act, a Lokpal Bill, which will be independent of the government and would be able to investigate and punish those from guilty for corruption. A lot of this was, of course, triggered by the 2G spectrum scam, the Commonwealth Games scam,